Over. Welcome and thank you for coming to the library's third and final installment in our programs on classic mysteries, musicals, and now creature features of the classic era. Thanks to Laura Jandasek for being our producer today, to the staff of the Waupaca, Wisconsin Public Library, of course, to all of you for being with us. I have a lot to cover today, so I'll move along a little quickly. I want to do a couple of housekeeping things first, though, and acknowledge my indebtedness for this lecture to a couple of sources, Stanley J. Solomon, Beyond Formula, his book in 1976, and Bill Warren, Keep Watching the Skies, the 21st Century Edition in 2010. Those are very useful sources for any kind of research into this area. And I have a little housekeeping on corrections from previous talks. On the mystery talk, two talks back, I inadvertently referred to Charlie Grapewin as in Ellery Queen as playing Paw Jode in The Grapes of Wrath. In fact, he played Grandpa Jode. And in the musicals program and romances, when talking about the movie Before Sunset, I said it was 1994. Of course, it's really 2004. So thanks to those who caught those and for keeping me honest. I'll try to be as honest as I can today and careful with creature features of the classic era, as you see on the screen, nightmares, horrors, and science fiction. A couple of reminders, as usual.
You have one new message, Friday, 1:33 p.m.
I'm sorry.
The eligibility for rate reduction is about to expire. Press 1 for more information.
Message deleted. End of messages.
I'm sorry, Laura, messages are coming through. Is that all right? Shall I go on? Okay, a reminder about the classic era. This is the period from 1927 to 1968 that we're discussing. The classic period goes from the advent of sound in 27 to the production code conclusion in 1968. And the films discussed today will be merely a fraction of those available during that period. If you haven't been with me before, you know that films theorists put these units into various different eras. The silent era, of course, the classic era, 27 to 68, the modern era, and then finally the contemporary era in which we now are, for purposes of kind of organizing film scholarship. And in the silent era, there were a few good creature features that come to mind right away. The Phantom of the Opera, Metropolis, The Lost World, and some sound serials that were also pretty good. The Phantom Empire, Superman, Undersea Kingdom. But in the interest of time, of course, we're not going to discuss the silence, but we're also not going to be able to discuss the serials because we just have to draw the line somewhere. I think what we do discuss will be the mainline feature films. Now, a definition of film genres, again, for those who haven't heard any of these lectures before. A genre is a specific type of film characterized by a commonality of repetition of plots, location, style. Not a general true-to-life drama with real people exactly, but something like westerns, mysteries, musicals, World War II, or today creature features. And to get right to it, we're going to have to acknowledge at the very beginning that the classification of films reviewed today has, by critical consensus, produced an unusually large number of regrettably bad, downright awful pictures. We might as well say that to begin with, although we will be focusing on the good ones. But there are some real stinkers in the list of science fiction horrors and nightmares. And many people tend to define the genre by these bad ones. There is a book by Stephen Miller that Glenda gave me a few years ago, very, very good book with an interesting title. It really deals with all kinds of bad movies, and 2/3 of the movies in this book, 100 of the 150, are in fact science fiction, nightmares, and horrors. Remember, this is about bad movies only. And the title is 150 Movies to Die Before You See. This is by Stephen Miller in 2010. And just to list a few of these so you can see the schlock that was put out there, Astro Zombies, Creature with the Atom Brain, Werewolf in a Girl's Dormitory, Santa Claus Conquers the Martian, Cat Women of the Moon, and on and on. In fact, there's a list in John Stanley's book on this subject, 1988. There's a list of all the movies alphabetically, all of them in this era. And you can see what is going on by just listening to a list that I'll read of those that start with the words attack of. I thought this was just a good example to use this. In the classic era alone, we had attack from space, attack of the crab monsters, attack of the 50-foot woman, attack of the giant leeches, attack of the Mayan mummy, attack of the mushroom people, of the puppet people, of the robots, and even moving into the modern era, of the killer tomatoes, which was at least a spoof, of the swamp creature, and the worst of the lot, the attack of the horny gorilla in 1976. And yet, of course, there are some solid, well-made pictures in this genre, movies that combine horror, nightmares, and science fiction, and we will in a second start with one of the best. As we move through these creature features, I will stop to recommend a few films I think are at the top of the heap in this genre and worth a second look today. Laura, let's start with the first image from a movie everyone will remember, King Kong, of course, recently on Turner Classic Movies again, the RKO release in 1933. This movie, I think, has the elements of all three, the nightmare, the horror, and the science fiction, and we'll get our terms defined in just a moment. But I wanted to start with this one because everything works in this picture. Here we are with Kong and the pterodactyl, and you can see in this publicity shot, the pterodactyl has Fay Wray by its claw down there below. This scene is not precisely in the movie. It's a publicity shot. We actually get this from a different angle in the movie, but I thought it illustrated well that King Kong was not really a very big object, nor was the pterodactyl, but they're moving so fast that we suspend our disbelief and watch as if they are really the right size and the right terror to keep us scared and keep us entertained and following the plot. This is, of course, a recommended movie. Fay Wray, Robert Armstrong, Bruce Cabot, you know the story, directed by Marion C. Cooper and Ernest Shadsack, but the special effects are the star by Willis O'Brien. He and his student Ray Harryhausen would be masters of stop motion photography, and they would manage all kinds of special effects. Quite remarkable for 1933. Now I'm going to divide nightmare, horror, and science fiction while we leave this up. The movie clearly has all three. There is a dreamlike, nightmarish quality right from the very beginning. The ship is at harbor in the fog in New York. He's looking for a woman to play the part in this adventure, this movie, very mysterious. There is a long journey and more fog to an unknown locale. The fog part's enough for you to see Skull Island. We discover the lost world. Then, like a dream that will not quit, we come back to New York City for Kong's rampage in New York. And so, while we leave this up, let me draw a distinction. Horrors, nightmares, and science fiction. I'm doing them this way because all of them had certain eras in which they flourished, certain decades. The horror picture of Dracula, Frankenstein, in the 1930s particularly, but of course ongoing even to the present day. Then in 1940, with a greater interest in psychiatry, psychology, the effects of World War II, now we get the nightmare pictures. They also continue to the present day. And by a nightmare picture, we mean one in which there may not be a real monster, but we are in fact, or there may be, but we are getting even so something that scares us so much that keeps repeating some primordial fears that we have in our past. And then in science fiction, the name of course speaks for itself, that flourishes in the 1950s in Hollywood. So let's start with the horror films, leaving King Kong up for just a moment. And these horror films scare us, as nightmares do, usually through supernatural means, appealing to our basic instinct not to look. We don't want to look, but we can't take our eyes off the screen. You know the feeling. You're watching one of these creepy movies and you say, don't go in the basement, don't go in the basement. And the character goes in the basement. Or the people who tell us they watch most of the modern movie Alien from between the seats. Or when they were a little kid, they went to see Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. And it was so terrifying for her running through the forest, the alligators and everything that appears. Of course, it's really in her imagination, that they had to look through their fingers in order to watch it. But they watched, they kept watching. Carl Gustav Jung, the famous psychiatrist in Man and His Symbols, tells us about these primordial fears that we cannot shake, They're there all the time. They're with us. They're our waking nightmares, buried deeply in the subconscious. Everyone, even practically from birth, his theory is, has symbols that terrorize and scare. The wolf, the werewolf, the undead, listing them, prehistoric animals, rats, snakes, vampires, and bats. And with that, we go to the next slide, which is Dracula, 1931. And here is Bela Lugosi in his signature role at his best. His career misfired later in life, but he certainly was at his best in this particular movie. And look how he is lighted here in this direction by Todd Browning, so that his eyes are so much the focus. You cannot take your eyes off his eyes, and his eyes transfix the victim. I'm not really recommending this one as one of our dozen or so list because it is a little creaky now, but it was very scary in 1931. And one of the characteristics that Dracula has is a typical horror formula, nightmare formula especially, he keeps returning and returning. No matter how many times the stake is driven into his heart, there's always a sequel. And no matter how many times we quell our nightmare about this character, he is always with us. Pretty much typical horror formula otherwise for this movie, based on a stage play. The monster appears, the monster rampages, and the monster is disposed of. Although, as I say with Dracula, never quite really. Same year, 1931, next slide, Frankenstein, also released by Universal International. And look at this colorful poster. Let's stop over this one for just a moment. Frankenstein, the man who made a monster, with Colin Clive, et cetera. Notice a couple of things. Number one, at the very top, Carl Laemmle presents. He was the head of Universal, and he made them the top studio in the horror and nightmare division. The man who made a monster, clearly distinguishing between Dr. Victor Frankenstein, called Henry in the movie, and the monster himself. Little kids tended, and even the general public after a while, to think of Boris Karloff as Frankenstein, thinking that was the name of the monster. But we know that that was really not, that Frankenstein was the doctor. But Boris Karloff, next thing to notice on the poster, who really had a breakout role here and made this his own, became famous because of it, gets fourth billing after the doctor and his sweetheart and one of his confreres and assistants, and there we have it, Boris Karloff, then the other people. But Boris is fourth listed. That would not last. He would be so famous pretty soon, he would only be billed by the one word Karloff in several of the movies he made in the 30s. So here we are in the 30s, and we are fully immersed in this kind of horror picture with nightmarish qualities. It gives you all you need on the poster, based on the novel by Mary Wollstonecraft Shelley. It calls it a story, actually a novel, and adapted by John L. Balderston from a play, and Balderston was a major writer of the day. He also worked on Dracula. So, directed by James Whale, this is a pretty good poster, and it is a very good movie, but I'm going to hold off on recommending it because it's the next one that I wanted to recommend, which is The Bride of Frankenstein. So we'll go to that, and here we have an iconic image. Elsa Lanchester as the bride. She also plays Mary Shelley in a prologue. This movie is 4 years later. Karloff is now playing the monster again. This is the awakening scene where she sees him for the first time in the laboratory, and she wants nothing to do with him. And you can see the electric shock of white hair in her hairpiece there. And you can see in the monster, because Karloff was very good at his role in evoking pity, he hopes that she will like him, but that hope is soon to fade. There are characteristics of the horror genre that we will discuss here for just a moment, but a couple of more facts about this one. This is a creepy, moody film. I'm recommending it, The Bride of Frankenstein, 1935. It does a great job of making us feel a certain amount of pity and loathing at the same time for this hideous, unfortunate monster. These things that happen to him really don't seem to be his fault. If you've seen the movie, you know that he has an interlude with a kindly hermit who is blind, who can't see him, played by O.P. Hagee, and they really have some good times together, breaking bread and smoking cigars and listening to music and playing music, and it's a very heartwarming kind of scene. Universal was pretty good in their scripts, and Balderston was good in this, in the scripts he did for them, of giving us sympathy for the outcast so that our feelings are mixed. And if you think back to King Kong, nobody likes to see him shot off the Empire State Building. We would rather King Kong maybe, you know, did a little better. He gets one of those airplanes in the movie and the audience typically cheers. We get sorry for werewolves because they can't help it. We're sorry for Dr. Jekyll, although it's of his own doing. And we're certainly sorry for the Frankenstein monster. One critic has said, Stanley Solomon, to think about this for a moment, for most of the movie, The Bride of Frankenstein, the monster played by Karloff is the single most frightened character in the whole movie. It's not the townspeople, it's not the assistants, it's the monster himself, because he is so bewildered and so scared and doesn't understand what's going on around him. Another thing we want to say before we leave the horror genre of the 30s and beyond, that there are three characteristics of this genre I want to just mention to you if you're taking notes. Or if you later watch this on YouTube, you can watch again and maybe get these three down more firmly in your mind. Number one, the depiction I've already mentioned of archetypal fears, the werewolf, the bat, the vampire. Secondly, the degree of unpreparedness of the victim. Think about this in these movies, even in the more modern or contemporary movies, the movies that are straightforwardly gory, that usually teenagers are in peril. People will do some things irrespective of what's about to befall them. Somebody will be running around having a good time, out there camping for the weekend, partying, whatever, and a monster lurks out there in the dark. They're unprepared for what happens. And the third thing is the vitality or strength of the source of horror, the vitality or strength. So they underestimate, they're unprepared, the victim and the monster or the figure that's harassing them, it might be a human, is stronger, more vital, and more evil than they really think. So we have the analogy of a python that is about to eat little mice for its dinner. And people report in zoology that what happens is the mouse usually preens itself and goes on as though nothing's happening. And then wham, the python gets it. That's the end of the mouse. That's very similar to what happens in a lot of these horror movies. So you have number one, the archetypes. Number two, the unpreparedness of the victim. And number three, think about it, the amazing strength and vitality of the creature. Now, this didn't stop in the 1930s, nor did Universal. The next slide shows a late Universal monster, the creature from the Black Lagoon. This, of course, is our iconic fear of the water. Think in the modern era of Jaws, for example. We don't know what's swimming beneath that water. Julie Adams, the heroine, in a memorable scene in this movie, swims in the Black Lagoon up on the top of the water, while down below, the creature follows her with great interest, has a water ballet, never attacks her, but it's certainly a remarkable scene, and it does keep us very fearful and watching every minute. This is directed by Jack Arnold. This is Rico Browning in a creature outfit. He played him in the water. Ben Chapman played him out of the water. So they had two different people with two different talents in the rubber suits, and there we were with a creature from the Black Lagoon. While I'm not specifically recommending this movie, I do think that people who know the horror movies think of it as one of the better of the late creature movies, even though we know before we suspend our disbelief that it kind of looks like a man in a suit. Now, I believe the creature up for just a minute, and we will move on to nightmares. This is a second genre. We've looked at horrors first. The nightmare flourished in the 1940s. And a key question for this one and all of these, just not just that the titles of some of the bad ones are bad. How do we tell the good from the bad and the ugly? How do we tell the good? Just look at the creature for a moment and keep thinking as you think of his claws and his scales and that black lagoon, meaning water so dark we can't peer into it, that the best films of all these genres and maybe all genres tell us something above and beyond the genre. So when we feel pity for the creature, or King Kong, 'twas beauty killed the beast, or the Frankenstein monster who doesn't understand why he's being locked up and torched and so forth and harassed by the townspeople, We are hearing something about human nature. We're being told something beyond the genre. If it has not an outright step to the telephone message, but at least something that makes us think about the future of the universe, the role of humans toward other species, the human condition itself, the best of these science fiction, horror, and nightmarish movies have this quality. Secondly, a sense of style and craftsmanship goes without saying, and they have to create a sense of terror, third and last, that would cause us to suspend our disbelief and stop saying it's only a movie and really believe it. And the way they get us to believe it, Stanley Solomon says, is they rely more on the suggestive inducement of terror than on the actual presentation of the horrifying. He makes the point that the more often you see the monster in a monster movie, the less scared you are of that monster. You're really worried before you ever see it. When you see it, you gasp. You keep seeing it. Pretty well, the audience assimilates it, moves on, and isn't so scared anymore. And so the kinds of movies that Solomon thinks will last longer are those that induce terror by suggestion. Now, Alfred Hitchcock famously said, suspense does not consist of sudden bang. It consists of the anticipation of the bang. And movies that do that were produced in the 1940s, a fine set of films by the great producer Val Lewton, working with Jacques Tourneur, Robert Wise, and Mark Robeson as directors. We'll go straight from The Creature to another scene in the water. The next slide, Jane Randolph, the terrorized near victim, our viewpoint character at this moment, and you can see her eyes, Jane Randolph in Cat People, released by RKO in 1942, and yes, remade 40 years later to little effect with CinemaScope and Technicolor, you might say. But here in black and white on a low budget, creating very wonderful effects of terror and belief, Jane Randolph is treading water in this basement YWCA pool. The problem is her stalker is a lady who apparently turns into a Black Panther and is out to kill her because of jealousy over a boyfriend. And so Jane is in the pool. She knows nobody else is down there. Help is far away and up a flight if she could scream to get anybody. And so all she can do is tread water and look at the eyes, the direction. She is watching very carefully. And what happens around the perimeter, we start to see the shadows, the ripples, the water, and then we start to see the figure of a cat prowling the pool after her. Now, spoiler alert, in this particular case, she gets out of the dilemma and she thinks it must all have been just a nightmare. But then when she goes upstairs, the lady who's the attendant says, "Well, look, honey, while you were swimming, somebody or something shredded your bathrobe." And then we know that something was going on, but we didn't actually see very much, but we surely got scared. This happens over and over again in Cat People, a recommended movie, directed by Val, produced, excuse me, by Val Lewton, L-E-W-T-O-N, and certainly worth seeing. I'm also gonna recommend a second one of his, and you might wanna do either or. I can see Cat People or this other one. This one has perhaps the most lurid title of all the movies we'll talk about today. This next slide is the poster for I Walked with a Zombie, produced by Val Lewton. Now, to his defense, Val Lewton had this unit with RKO Radio producing these pictures, making good money on a limited budget, very inventive, but he had to take the titles that they gave him. They said, make a movie called Cat People. That's what he made. Curse of the Cat People. That's what he made. The Body Snatcher, The Ghost Ship, The Leopard Man, and I Walked with a Zombie. It does have a tenuous relation to Walking with a Zombie, again, a recommended movie, but the lurid poster is different from what we see on screen. What we really see is essentially a triangle, you might say a quadrangle, of a very dark, dark love story. A woman who is married to one brother on the island of San Sebastian falls in love with his brother, and the whole episode turns her into a catatonic trance after a fever, so that we finally learn gradually that she cannot speak, She cannot see. She does not bleed if she is stabbed, and therefore she qualifies, you might say, as a zombie. And Frances D., who plays the nurse, has come to take care of her. This is based loosely, believe it or not, on Charlotte Bronte's novel Jane Eyre, because the husband brother keeps her locked up in a tower, just like Rochester kept his first wife in a tower in Jane Eyre. Here we have Jacques Tourneur directing again, and it really is a good, moody picture, concluding with a song verse by Sir Lancelot, who is a calypso singer who follows through this movie, coming in and out and giving parts of the plot. And at the very last of his song, he says, oh, the brothers are lonely and the nurse is young, and now you know my song is sung. It comes to no good end. It has a tragic ending. It's really a very good picture, but Mrs. Val Lewton, according to the Hollywood story, said to her husband when he said, oh, come with me to the premiere tonight. This is really one of my very best pictures. And she said, dear, I don't care how good it is, I'm not going to a theater to see a movie called I Walked with a Zombie. And so she didn't go. Notice on that poster, one last thing, Dutch angle, I walked with a, it's going up from bottom left up to upper right, and then zombie is in different kind of lettering. So we're supposed to be scared, the hand reaching out. This isn't exactly what we see in the movie, but we do see the lady in white who can't speak, walking the grounds at night. The next one is equally gothic, you might say, and that's Night of the Hunter, which is coming up next on the slide. This is an interesting, quirky movie with a script by James Agee, the great critic, and the only movie ever directed by the actor Charles Laughton. This is released by United Artists in 1955. Look at that set. Shelley Winters is on the bed. Robert Mitchum is standing with his back to her. This is a scene in which he murders her. And would you look at all that we see and can deduce about this movie? The chest of drawers or mirror, whatever it is, over to the left, the little light there, the light cannot possibly drench us in light like that. It must be the light of the moon coming in. It's extremely dark for most of the picture. It puts children in peril in a gothic extended nightmare. This is a hard movie to watch because after he does away with Shelley, he starts after her little kids. They have to flee down the river, always looking back to see if the minister is following them, constantly singing in a menacing way, leaning on the everlasting arms. And so he excites a great deal of terror in us and is a human monster in this movie, which I'm not fully recommending because the list can only be so long, but any of these, I think you'll enjoy watching. We're still gonna go further into the nightmares into the 60s early. Roger Corman, the producer of a great deal of early schlock, did find a better quality of movies when he moved to adaptations of Edgar Allan Poe. The next slide is 1961 American International, The Pit and the Pendulum. Now look at the thought they've put into this set. So you have this ruined Spanish Inquisition chamber. Vincent Price in the monk's robe or inquisitor's robe, bending over a helpless John Kerr on the table. He's tied down. The pendulum is going to swing. You can either roll to the left if he weren't chained down and fall into the deep bottomless pit and be killed, or you can wait for the worst fate, the pendulum, which will swing back and forth until in its regular clock-like precision, it cuts across the chest and slices the victim in half. This, of course, is Edgar Allan Poe. Did you notice James Agee, the script, Mary Wollstonecraft Shelley, Edgar Allan Poe, these writers somehow result in better movies. The better the script, the better the movie, go figure. And the better the screenwriter, the better the script, and the better the source material, the better the script. So here we have Vincent Price, the nightmarish scene from The Pit and the Pendulum toward the conclusion of the movie. But next slide, Laura, is The Pit and the Pendulum. But look, we're backstage. There is John Kerr lying down on the table. He's not really strapped in. There's the pendulum with his hand on it, and in black hair is Roger Corman in the black sweater. And he is directing the movie, showing how it will work. And to his left, to his right, but to our left, Vincent Price with gray hair. You can see him there with his Inquisitor costume. The head is off, the hood is off. And here's the crew standing around, smoking and joking, you might say, getting ready for them to do the next take on The Pit and the Pendulum. If you've seen these performances here before, you know that I like to show you some backstage scenes so that periodically we can talk about the movies being in the business of fooling us, and illusion and reality. Illusion, what we just saw in color, black and white. Here we are backstage in The Pit and the Pendulum, and this keeps us saying it's only a movie. Roger Corman also produced and directed a number of Poe classics, most of them with Vincent Price: The Raven, The House of Usher, The Premature Burial, The Tomb of Ligeia, on and on and on. And the next slide, I'm recommending this next one, though it's hard to watch, the one considered perhaps his masterpiece, 3.5 stars in Maltin's classic movie guide, The Mask of the Red Death. This will be released by American International in 64, a collaboration of Edgar Allan Poe, you might say, Roger Corman and Vincent Price, but with a considerable debt to Ingmar Bergman, The Seventh Seal and other movies, and later on Woody Allen in Love and Death would use a similar procession yet again. Here we have five of the seven plagues going over the land. There's the Red Death right in the middle. And the premise is that these folks wander the land with different forms of pestilence, decimating the countryside, which, as you can see there, is all desolate to begin with now after they have been at work. And Count Prospero thinks in the story and in the movie that he can avoid the Red Death by bringing all of his courtiers and the ladies he finds attractive into his castle, where they're well provisioned and they can just wait it out. During the COVID epidemic, this is a hard, hard movie to watch. And the idea is, of course, that you can't keep out the Red Death. And so toward the end of the film, we will see the tragic consequences of Vincent Price, Prince Prospero's miscalculation about how thoroughly penetrating the Red Death can be if it wants to get you. Mask of the Red Death, our recommended movie. I'm gonna leave that up just a moment because I wanted to use it as a background for and for the rest of our slides as well. Pauline Kael, the great critic, had this to say about horror and science fiction movies, and she really was a great critic. You can tell more about horror and science fiction films from the still photographs than you can tell about any other genre. She goes on to explain, you can tell more by the photographs than about any other genre, that you can a little bit with musicals, but it's a little harder with other genres if you think about it, and certainly with regular dramas. You can show a slide of Bette Davis talking to Miriam Hopkins, an old acquaintance. You can show a slide of Susan Hayward talking to John Gavin in Backstreet. Those are regular dramas, you might say. You can even include Joan Crawford and Anne Blythe and Mildred Pierce. And you still don't tell as much from a slide like this about a movie as when you see these things, you iconically just see them. There's the nightmare and you are trapped in it. And all you need to do, if you've ever seen the movie, it comes back with a rush. If you haven't, you can notice the problems are inherent. They're going to be available in the movie for you to view. The next one certainly illustrates that. Whatever Happened to Baby Jane, with a human monster played by Bette Davis, allegedly helping, but we know imprisoning, her sister played by Joan Crawford in this United Artists release late in the career of these two stars in 1962. Crawford would go on to make other horror and monster and suspense type movies like I Saw What You Did and Berserk. Bette Davis, Hush Hush Sweet Charlotte, but it starts here with Whatever Happened to Baby Jane, an innocuous, allegedly, child star and her sister growing up to be elderly and living in the past and living in complete horror and fear. I am recommending this movie, and I would star this movie because it really started a fashion in the 60s for a Grand Guignol type comedy, drama, nightmare, icky kind of movie that many people find pretty interesting. I find it interesting, but many people find this somewhat more entertaining than I do. But it was good to see the old stars at work again. And it certainly, directed by Robert Aldrich, is a riveting sort of performance by Bette Davis and Joan Crawford. You don't want to leave your chair, and yet you don't want to really watch it either. So another nightmare. But we're going to wrap up the nightmares with the absolute towering achievement in the nightmare category in the classic era. And this is, as you'll tell from the first slide, I bet you know the movie, Psycho with Janet Leigh. The iconic shower scene, most iconic of them all. There she is, the Robert Bolt story, and then the movie. And there's a little Wisconsin connection, as we all know, to this story with Block, with his connection to the area. But what we're talking about today is not the historical background, but we did want to talk about this scene. Alfred Hitchcock would remind us in later interviews, this scene lasts only 47 seconds in the shower at the Bates Motel. There is no penetration with the knife. The audience never sees, as Hitchcock said, the knife going into the skin of the young woman. That does not happen. He filmed it in black and white, we also learn, because the Hershey syrup they were using to simulate blood would be too obvious if it were in color. So we made it in black and white. So when that syrup and water go down the drain, then we think it's the real thing. We've suspended our disbelief. This, of course, is a very dislocating scene for audiences. This is Janet Leigh, as I say, and we think from the beginning of the movie that she will be our viewpoint character, but one third of the way through the movie, she meets her fate here in the shower. I'm sure some of you have heard the Hollywood story, evidently true, that Janet Leigh said in interviews late in life, the one thing she never did the rest of her life was take a shower. Never with a curtain. And why not when you've had that experience, even filming? Let's go to the next slide, though, and remind ourselves that it was only a movie. Here is Alfred Hitchcock directing the shower sequence in Psycho, just like Roger Corman directing in The Pit and the Pendulum. Backstage view, illusion and reality, Hitchcock always having great fun with the audience. As a matter of fact, so much fun that after he made North by Northwest, you might like this quotation from the master. He made North by Northwest in 59 with Cary Grant, Eva Marie Saint, a huge hit, a wonderful suspense movie, one of his best. And after it was over, he was asked by an interviewer, now that you've had such a success with North by Northwest, what is your next project? And Hitchcock said with his typical straight face, oh, I'm going to make a much quieter film now. It's about a young man who runs a motel. You know how the story came out. Okay, other good nightmare films I don't have a slide for. Two more. The Innocents, released in 61, story by Henry James, starring Deborah Carr. And The Haunting, released in 63, Shirley Jackson story, based on The Haunting of Hill House with Claire Bloom. I think you'll enjoy those movies if you get a chance, but we'll stick to our star movies and turn away from this nightmare and horror, and we need to move on to science fiction. But before we get there, we're gonna take a detour, which I hope you'll enjoy, through the bad and the ugly. We've been looking at the good, but we did acknowledge at the beginning that this genre has produced a lot of bad. Sometimes endearing, sometimes hilarious, often just plain bad. The kind of movies that make you think of the old line, you know, that picture wasn't released, it escaped. And so we're going to talk about some of those, usually most easily observed in the 1950s and usually involving either a visitor from space or a missile to the moon or a monster mutant produced by the atomic bomb. Many of these associated with American pictures, later American International. Sometimes people ask, well, why were there so many of these bad movies, hundreds of them, really just enormous quantities of these movies? We'll keep a Psycho up with Hitchcock for just a minute because we'll see the contrast between the good and the bad. And I think two reasons, really. Movies were winding down a little bit in the 50s in popularity. Television, of course. In 1948, there were 1 million TV sets in the United States. And in 1952, 4 years later, 21 million sets. Look at that exponential growth, and on it went. And on the way to the saturation of television, of course, getting in the car and going to a theater lost out to simply sitting with your family at home. So that was one thing, but why did that bring about so many quick films? Because the market for other more important movies tended to be drying up. The last B-series Westerns ended in 1953. Various types of genres went to television. The detectives went to the television, sitcoms went, all kinds of things moved over to television, and we didn't have as much going on in movie production. But one area that did flourish was drive-in movie theaters. In 1955, here's a statistic you might find interesting. There were 19,200 theaters in the United States, 19,200 movie theaters in the United States. 25% were drive-ins. Now, of course, today with the malls, of course, COVID has changed everything, but with the malls and so forth and the quadruplexes, things have become very different. But in those days, standalone theaters were typically one theater, one building, and then the drive-ins took over. There was still a market in these drive-ins for appealing to some extent, families, but mostly teenagers, teenagers on dates. What did you want? You wanted something that would simply just scare you. And so they produced a lot of schlocky movies, and they had a technique called saturation booking. Let's go to our next example. First example, truly bad movie, The Beast with a Million Eyes, an unspeakable horror, destroying and terrifying. In fact, this movie is about growers and farmers out in the Imperial Valley and a discordant family. And allegedly, this beast is an alien presence that turns people against each other. So this family bickers at the dinner table all the time, not because of their upbringing or their conflicts they have, but because the beast with a million eyes has made them turn against each other. There is no picture of a girl in a negligee in the movie, just in the poster. So you've got this man, wife, and daughter bickering all the time. You have a teenager from down the road who wanders in and out. And the most exciting thing happens in the whole movie is that an old man is attacked by his dog. That's a dog turns against him. The beast has evidently used psychological powers. The director and the crew brought this back to the producers at American Films and said, here's our movie. Well, we have an ad campaign with this beast. Your movie doesn't even have a beast in it. You don't have anything except a suggestion of a beast. We can't sell this. How are we going to do it? Get me a beast. You have 24 to 48 hours to come up with a beast. And so, next slide, please, Laura. This was the beast they created. Does that look like a million eyes? It's actually a hand puppet emerging from his rocket ship. He is either the beast or perhaps his assistant, but when people see that we know the worth of that statement I made a little while ago, the more you see the monster, the less afraid you are. Reaction most people have is, oh, he's kind of cute, and he's only a hand puppet, so he isn't very big or very scary. All the rest of this is not of much interest. Well, they use this saturation booking, which is very simple. You give a lurid poster, you open it everywhere in a big hurry, you make people think everyone's rushing to see this movie, you show it for about a week, you close it down, you get out of town, you've made your money before the word of mouth can say, this is a lousy movie. They kept doing this, and this is responsible for just a few of the hundreds of really bad and ugly movies made in the 50s on these premises. Let's look at the next one. The next one, next slide, Teenage Caveman. Also American International. Look at the huge, scary dinosaur. And look at the boy down there with the spear and the young lady in diaphanous sort of barely apparel in the pond behind. In the movie, we see neither the big beast nor a blonde champion nor a lady in a pond like that. That doesn't matter. The poster has already done its job. What we do see in the movie, a black and white 65-minute very tedious film with Robert Vaughn in his beginning roles and no means a blonde person. What we see instead is an actor named Beach Dickerson in a bear suit who attacks the kid who has a kind of a hatchet, not really a lance like that at all. And then they have not a prehistoric monster in sight. but evidently a nuclear survivor type of old man, was also Beach Dickerson playing another role in another suit. So he got to play both the bear and the nuclear survivor in this movie. Roger Corman is listed down in the lower right as director, produced and directed by Roger Corman. A film so bad that Roger Corman himself in later life said to an interviewer, "No, you're wrong. I never directed a movie called Teenage Caveman. Don't talk to me about it. I never did that." And that's the way that that was left. Another one with a monster that isn't very scary is our next slide. Also from Corman in his early days, Attack of the Crab Monsters. Now, this is a papier-mâché monster in a movie released in 1957. They're on an island that is sinking, and crab monsters are attacking the surviving people who are left on the island. That's a papier-mâché product, and the actor Beach Dickerson, who earlier we learned played a bear and a nuclear survivor, is inside the crab monster trying to move it a little bit so it'll look quasi-authentic. He can get it a few feet this way and a few feet another way. Then they got another actor to get in there with him, and by squeezing in very tightly, they could move forward and backward just a little bit. The crab monster wasn't going to scare anybody, although Corman does get a little bit of tension here and there throughout the movie, but a lot of laughs as well. The next one, I'm going to hold the next slide a minute till I can show you how bad it is. Because one of the critics wrote, and I really like this quote, about The Giant Claw, 1957. "Perhaps no single science fiction picture has ever provided more unintentional, harmless, hilarious laughter than The Giant Claw. It must be seen to be believed." So let's see The Giant Claw in this next slide. There he is. This directed by Fred F. Sears. I should say he. We learn later this is a she. She has an egg. But The Giant Claw, Columbia, 1957, it wasn't only American International, there is the bird on full display. Now this movie has some scenes that are okay as long as the bird is not around. You know, people in a convertible with a giant claw coming down on them, people in an airplane seeing a giant claw come toward them. And so we've got a problem. We have to extinguish the monster, have to get rid of it, and so on. But what they did was they shopped out the special effects, and they were going to cut the bird pictures in later. And what happened when they got the footage back is what they had was sort of a pinata. They didn't really have a monster. The Giant Claw is a laughable bird and a terrible movie. But, you know, I can just tell right now that you're chuckling about this monster that's supposed to be so terrifying. We just have two more of these stinkers, and then we'll get wrap it up with the good science fiction movies of this era. This next one, the slide is ready to come up, is The Tingler. And here we have The Tingler attacking a projectionist in a movie theater. The movie released in 1959, produced by William Castle. William Castle was a producer of many of these movies, usually for Columbia and Allied artists, and they always had a gimmick. The House on Haunted Hill, Macabre, Mr. Sardonicus, movies you may or may never ever heard of, but The Tingler was perhaps, I won't say the best, but it was sort of the worst in many ways. It creates a certain amount of tension here and there, and it benefits from the presence of excellent character actors, Philip Coolidge and Judith Evelyn, but it is not really a very good movie. The theory is that The Tingler, that's that creature on his neck, lives in our spine, and when we're afraid of something, we will scream and the tingler will release and it will go away and we won't see it again. But if we can't scream or we're taken by too much surprise, now a projectionist can't start hollering very well and he would scare everybody down in the movie theater. So he can't really get a scream out and the tingler gets him. The tingler will kill you if you can't scream. And that's the premise, scream it away. William Castle wanted the audience screaming. So toward the end of the movie, we attack the projectionist, and then we say, "This is a public service announcement, ladies and gentlemen. The Tingler is loose in this theater." And Castle had arranged with the theaters that showed it to fix up some of the seats to give a buzz at that moment when the Tingler is seen entering the back of the theater on screen. The buzzers would go off, and every seventh or eighth person, I was at a showing of this as a teenager, would jump up and scream, because the tingler was after them. They didn't know the seats were going to buzz, I guess, and they would get this effect, and they would jump up and scream. Pretty soon, the whole audience was screaming, and then sure enough, the tingler would go away. 1959, another one that needs to be seen to be believed. And in the same year, last slide here, the movie usually called by most critics in any genre the worst film ever made, Plan 9 from Outer Space. You can see all of the money that went into this Edward D. Wood picture released by Distributors Corporation of America. This is the moment at which Tor Johnson, the large man in the middle, who has risen from the grave, turns against his master and helps foil the plot of Plan 9. What is Plan 9? Well, it turns out that an alien planet is attacking Earth, and there have been 8 plans before. They all failed, and so now they've resorted to Plan 9, which is to have people rise from their graves and go after designated targets. This is a pretty inept movie. If you want to see flying saucers, see this movie, and what you'll see is paper plates set on fire and hurled at the audience. So you get the idea of a flying saucer. Trouble is, you can also see the technician's hand sometime tossing the paper plates. It is so bad, it's almost good, but not good enough to recommend. You see that set? It has just that, they don't have enough money really for sets, so they just put a curtain up by the wall. They use the same curtain for many scenes, and they said it starred Bela Lugosi, but he's only in it 2.5 minutes because that's all the footage Ed Wood got of him before Bela died unexpectedly, and they still said starring Bela Lugosi on the posters, even though they couldn't use him, and so they put a cloak on a chiropractor that Ed Wood knew and had him go around not saying anything but holding the cape and the cloak up like this so you couldn't tell that it wasn't Bela Lugosi under that. I could go on and on about this movie, but you've seen enough. One picture tells all. Pauline Kael is right. If you see this picture, you know everything you need to know about Plan 9 from Outer Space. Now, that's a science fiction movie, I guess. We'll transfer over to science fiction now and talk, leaving that image up a moment, very quickly about the distinction between horror slash nightmare on the one hand and science fiction on the other. In the first, the danger lies in those symbol and nightmares that Carl Gustav Jung told us about. In science fiction, the danger usually originates in the outer world. Secondly, the psychological effects are important in the horror film. The logical possibilities are what are important in the science fiction film. And third and finally, dreams recur and our fears do not entirely disappear. So there's a constant source of fear available for people making horror and nightmare films. That's the interior of us. But in the science fiction movie, the characters are often quite able to handle the situation. A crisis arises, they take care of it, they usually destroy the monster, be it whoever, and the monster, except for sequels, of course, doesn't really come back very often, and so we can lapse back into a comfortable reality. There's overlapping, of course, but if you look at science fiction as the outer world, logical possibilities, and the character's ability to handle the situation in most cases, then the horror films as danger inside us, psychological effects, and recurring dreams that don't ever quite disappear, you get an interesting distinction between the two. So I'm going to focus, there are many good ones, I'm going to focus on just a few as we move toward the conclusion of our talk. The first of these, we'll show the slide now, Laura, is The Thing from Another World, released in 1951 by RKO. That is James Arness, excuse me, in the title role of The Thing, a giant vegetable or carrot, evidently, standing there in the doorway. He is about to meet his demise in this movie based on a story by John Campbell Jr. called Who Goes There? Christian Nyby is the credited director, but Howard Hawks actually seems to have directed the movie. Nyby reported to him and was an editor and assistant director. He gets screen credit, but Howard Hawks of Red River and so many other fine pictures directed this fast-paced, effective story, remade much more explicitly and, to my mind, to lesser effect in '82. It's really a combination of The Old Dark House and science fiction unknown, the flying saucer lands in the Arctic, and the scientists try to take care of it, find out what it is, and reluctantly find out that it's terrible. This is an example of the unpreparedness of the victims and the strength and surprising strength of the alien. This is recommended, The Thing from Another World. I'm talking so much, my voice is going to make me pop a cough drop here, so bear with me and we'll go on anyway. The next one, also recommended, is The Day the Earth Stood Still. We should have a picture of the poster coming up here, and there it is. From Out of Space, a Warning and an Ultimatum. The Day the Earth Stood Still is not a destroy the whole Earth picture. As you may know, it's an intelligent, sympathetic alien in the person of Michael Rennie, with his robotic assistant Gort, shown here, with his ray that indeed deals out destruction if it has to. But it is a message he brings to Earth, that there is a way to our salvation. There is a way to Earth saving itself, and that involves lots of changes the world is going to have to make. Again, it's by Edmund North, who wrote a number of great movies you may have seen, like the script for Sink the Bismarck and other genres besides this one, directed by Robert Wise, who would later win the Oscar for directing The Sound of Music. Very good credentials for this movie, with Michael Rennie, Academy Award-winning actress Patricia Neal. And I think you'll like it if you haven't seen it. It is a much admired movie, a very intelligent movie, and one in which we learn a lot about what good can come from other worlds, and teaches us a lot about sympathy toward creatures not like us. Well worth seeing today. And remember, those of you who know this movie will know what I'm talking about, this recommended picture. Remember this phrase, Klaatu Barada Nikto. Klaatu Barada Nikto. See the movie and learn what I'm talking about. The next one, The Beast from 20,000 Fathoms, again has great credentials from a story, The Foghorn by Ray Bradbury, that appeared in the Saturday Evening Post. Here is the Redosaurus from deep in the bowels of the ocean attacking the lighthouse. Now, the story has mostly to do with the Redosaurus and the lighthouse, but the movie expands it considerably to take him to New York and other places. The danger with this beast is that he is equally at home on land as he is on sea. This was the prototype, Warner Brothers 1953, for a series of monster movies caused by mutation after the atomic bomb. In this case, we dislodge the animal who is frozen in ice in the Arctic, and suddenly we have chaos all over the world. Ray Harryhausen, following the great Willis O'Brien, did this stop motion photography, and The Beast from 20,000 Fathoms is worth watching. I'm not recommending it wholesale, but it is certainly good to see because it started a lot of the craze for so many good, bad, and ugly monster mutant movies that followed. One of those that I am recommending, next slide, is Them. That's the one about the giant ants, 1954. Joan Weldon and James Arness. He was in The Thing. He didn't get very far in 3 years. Here in 1954, he's an FBI man fighting the giant ants in this genre picture from Warners. Also starring Edmund Gwynn and James Whitmore. Good suspense, directed with great pacing by Gordon Douglas. Before we ever see the ants, who are believable enough and scary enough and certainly icky enough, but before we ever see them, we have 30 minutes or so of speculation about what is causing the death, what is scaring little children, what is going on in the desert. Them is certainly one that I'd want you to see. And it also makes us all ungrammatical, as in Them is a good movie. How do we say that? Them are? No, Them is a good movie. The next one is another of the mutant movies. We're gonna move fast here. This is Godzilla. You'd recognize him anywhere. 1954 version, directed by Ishiro Honda in Japan. However, what we most often see in this country is the 1956 re-edited version, Godzilla, King of the Monsters, released by Embassy in 1956 with inserted shots featuring Raymond Burr. Once again, we'll just show you how I'm not recommending this. I've always thought Godzilla looked a little goofy, but some people really like him, and he has appeared in movie after movie and has one coming out to a theater near you almost immediately in another battle with King Kong. Anyway, Godzilla, 1954-56. Let's go to the next slide, also for Godzilla, and look at this. Here we are making the movie backstage. A Japanese actor or technician, don't know his name, I'm sorry, is in the bottom half of a Godzilla suit, and with his big feet, he is about to stomp this replica of Tokyo. So they don't need to have the whole Godzilla monster head and all. All we need for this shot is the feet, because we're all we're going to do is see some stomping. You know, it's only a movie, folks, illusion and reality. On to one more, not recommended, but of interest because it was so popular on the teenage market. The Blob, released by Paramount in 58. Not technically a Hollywood movie because filmed 100% in Valley Forge, Pennsylvania. Strictly drive-in fare with homage to Bela Lugosi up there on the marquee after the Blob has already ingested several citizens, a doctor, a nurse, an old man, a projectionist, and many a mechanic, and many innocent bystanders. Steve McQueen's debut, tongue-in-cheek, The Blob, a matter of taste, I suppose, but it is funny. It spoofs itself, and it has a question about whether that's really the end of the monster at the end of the movie. We're on pace to finish in just a few moments. In the time we have, let's go to another recommended movie, special effects unexcelled, The Incredible Shrinking Man. And there he is, played by Grant Williams. He's in his fight with the spider. The movies by 1957, when Universal once again released this, still the king of the horror movies and the nightmares, now science fiction. In this case, what has happened? The same old atomic device, the atomic cloud, has attacked him on his ship, his boat, and his girlfriend was downstairs at the time in the cabin, but he was up on deck. And as a result, instead of turning into a giant monster, he gets smaller and smaller and smaller. Now he's as tall as a spool of thread. Earlier, he was a little bigger and fought a house cat, finally had to run from a terrifying fight with a house cat. Now he has to use his wits and a pin or a needle to try to fight the spider. Notice how cleverly this is put together. See the spools of thread, the thimble, all to illustrate the size, and see also the tape measure in the back showing the inches, all reinforcing in this wonderfully directed film by Jack Arnold, the reverse of the giant mutant picture, screenplay by the great science fiction author Richard Matheson of I Am Legend, made several times, and The Last Man on Earth, The Omega Man, several versions of that same story. So imaginative, great effects for its day, and I'm recommending this movie. Interestingly, no dialogue for the last one third of this film, except Grant Williams has sparse bits of narration. One third of the movie running time, no dialogue as he engages in fights for survival. Another fight for survival, Invasion of the Body Snatchers, largely regarded by critics as one of the very best of the 50s movies, more so for what it doesn't show than what it does. Directed by Don Siegel, who went on to the Dirty Harry pictures with Clint Eastwood. And I am recommending this movie as well. Screenplay by Daniel Mainwaring from a novel by Jack Finney. Tense, super scary. The aliens are among us, as you'll remember, the pod people, an analogy some people think for communism or the blacklisting of the McCarthy era. No place to hide if you're a normal person. They're the last two normal people, Dana Winter and Kevin McCarthy, fleeing the citizens of the village of Santa Mira, California, and pursued by the entire town out to get them for being normal. Their only sin is being normal. Recommended, tense, difficult, and with some good things to say about the human condition. And now to the science fiction movie most people remember most from the 50s, Forbidden Planet. I recommend this movie because of its outstanding notion that you might say we have to go to outer space to discover that the worst demons are all in our own mind. The poster of Robbie the Robot is fairly accurate, but he never carries Anne Francis in quite that alluring or lurid way. This is based on great source material. It's modeled on the Tempest by William Shakespeare. So as I say, we go to outer space only to discover how bad things are within our own id. The poster tells it all, sort of, see all that Beyond, they try to recreate that on Altair 4. They have a great job of special effects. It's thought-provoking, intelligent, ambitious, and worth a recommendation. By all means, try to look at Forbidden Planet if you look at no other movie from this science fiction part of this lecture today. Now, as we conclude, a little extra. I'm often asked by people if I could name a modern or contemporary example of the genre so they could see one of those in addition to the classic era. Mm-hmm, I can do that. We're going to recommend a movie that came out in 1981, that should be coming up now on your slide. Okay, Laura? An American Werewolf in London, the monster movie. Notice at the top, this is directed by John Landis, but it is not a comedy, though he's a comic director. From the director of Animal House, a different kind of animal. This is a horror movie, a science fiction movie, sort of, and a nightmare movie all together. It doesn't let up. It is not tongue-in-cheek. It is not a spoof. Griffin Dunne on the left is the friend. David Naughton is the young man on the right in the red who turns into the werewolf. To watch him turn into the werewolf is a marvel of Rick Baker's technique in morphing somebody from one to the other. He did the remake of The Thing and so many movies where he won Academy Awards for what he did in creating monsters. And certainly here, this one doesn't let up. They're walking in Scotland, they are pursued, they get off the road, the young man to the left is killed, the other one survives, but guess what? Of course, he becomes a werewolf. It will not let up, and you won't be able to keep from watching it, but it is more violent than the most of the movies I usually recommend. Also, I like the fact that they use music so well, and it's just kind of ironic that they use Blue Moon and Bad Moon Rising in this werewolf picture. Well, we're back to the closing credits, I think, Laura. And I did want to say to people, besides thank you for attending, this is the final talk in this series. And we hope that in the fall, we may be able at the Waupaca Public Library to get back to some sort of library film presentations. Hopefully all are in part in person, maybe all are in part virtual. But whatever it is, stay tuned in the meantime. Remember, whether you watch the Westerns, the mysteries, the musicals, the horrors, the nightmares, the science fiction, any of these genres we've discussed over the last 3 months, enjoy the movies, good, bad, or ugly. Have a good time at the movies. And thank you again and the library for having this series of programs this spring. Okay, ready for questions, if any.
Okay, Jack, I took you off the spotlight. So if anybody has any questions, please type them into the chat and I'll share them with Jack.
And if we don't get questions, we'll assume we covered everything.
Oh, it looks like we've got one here. Oh, okay. So one of our viewers asked about Bessela Pastor. I don't know if you ever saw that movie. My husband asked the question, and it was kind of a B movie about a pastor who had a dinosaur head. And they were eating things, you know, killing people or whatever.
That isn't immediately ringing a bell. Is it in the classic era?
I'm sorry.
Is it before 1968?
I'm thinking that it might have been after 1968. Let's see if he responds.
That might be my excuse. I don't think I recognize that movie, but it could be out of my field of expertise.
Oh, he's asking if it was a spoof. And it seemed like it. We watched it and it was kind of funny. I think it was kind of a...
Well, we learn something new all the time, and that's something else for us to look for, but that isn't one. I'm sorry. I wish I could shed more light, but I just can't.
Okay. So then we had a question from Bonnie Herzog. Is The Shining horror, nightmare, or what?
Okay, now that's an interesting one. That too is after the classic era. And you know, the classic era is where I'm best trained. But The Shining, I think, is something like a horror and a nightmare. You know, what they do so well in that movie is suggest so much. And one thing I think is strong about that picture is they never really fully explain what has happened, right? And we know that the movie differs from the book in a couple of important ways. But the way they chose to tell the story in the movie, we just go back at the very end and we go back to that picture that we've seen before of the Jack Nicholson character being one of many busboys or waiters in the black and white picture of the staff at the hotel in the days of yore. And now we're seeing what happened today in color, and we're not sure why he went and did the things he did, why he went evidently berserk, what it was about the hotel that made this happen. But we certainly get a sense of terror, and we get a sense of that implied Val Lewton kind of anything could happen any minute. So that when he comes through that door saying, you know, here he is, and so forth, it's very scary, and people jump out of their seats legitimately. And yet, if you think about it, not too many terrible, I mean, no great beast emerges and no explanation really emerges. I'm going to tie it over to one other movie, The Birds, which is in the classic era and does the same thing to us. We don't really get an explanation either in Daphne du Maurier's story or in Hitchcock's movie version of why the birds have turned against man. We are humanity. We see men and women fighting the birds. We see them terrorized by the birds, pecked to death by the birds, otherwise disposed of by the birds, but we never are given any explanation why. The car just creeps off at the end through the birds during one of their silent periods. Do they act with the tidal waves? What happens? The coming? We never know for sure why the birds did what they did or how they did it, but we do know that it happened in this story. And it's all the creepier because no explanation is offered. So it's probably not science fiction by my earlier definition, in which we hear about the logical possibilities and we confront them and we defeat them. We don't defeat the birds. At the end of Hitchcock's movie, they're still in control of Bodega Bay.
All right. Maggie Thompson had a comment. She said, by the way, Invaders from Mars was released 3 years before Invaders of the Body Snatchers with a similar theme. Your family and friends are dangerous because of alien invaders.
Yes. Is Invaders from Mars, well, I'll ask this back to Maggie. I'm trying to remember that one for sure. Is that the one where it turns out to be a dream? Spoiler alert, but it's one of those movies like that with a little boy. Is that the one we're talking about as opposed to It Came from Outer Space? Or I think maybe, I'm just trying to remember which is the best in there. And I'm afraid I'm not remembering it particularly well.
Maggie yeah. says, yes, the first one of those I ever saw.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. So I did have the right one. Yeah, there's at least an explanation that is offered for us, yeah. What do you think about the making of the War of the Worlds? Was that from the classic era? It certainly was. And I actually have a number of others that I think I'm going to introduce for just a minute. I don't have slides. Jan is asking about the War of the Worlds. Yes, that came out in 1953, released by Paramount, but George Pal, Special Effects, Academy Award for Special Effects. And that was a fantastic movie, remade with Tom Cruise, of course, much later in the 21st century. But excellent movie. And they did what they could with the special effects they had, and they were very effective at the time. And the others that I think from that era that I didn't, in the interest of time, mention, but I did want to at least give a shout out to, since we're on that topic, 1951, The Man from Planet X. Creepy and creaky, and not to everybody's taste, but works up a pretty good sense of eerie creepiness about this alien invader that first seems to come in peace and then is turned off by the way people behave. When Worlds Collide, 1951, Academy Award for Special Effects once again. Then The War of the Worlds, just two more. It Came from Outer Space, 53, and back in 1950, Rocket Ship XM, which some people like better than I do, but it certainly is, by any standard, better than trying to watch Cat Women of the Moon. Yes, any others?
Let's see, any other chats for Jack?
Otherwise, we're probably running over time, but yeah. I certainly have enjoyed doing these, Laura, and hope everybody enjoyed watching as much as I enjoyed doing them.
Yes, we appreciate you being here and doing these for us, Jack. Thank you. Okay.
Thank you.